This locomotive is worth almost $3 million. We have three of these on this train. And then you've got the containers with all the merchandise in them. It's a huge responsibility. But we're up for it, eh?
Yeah.
The Canadian Pacific crew must haul this vital $50 million load more than 3,000 kilometres from Vancouver to a rail yard in Vaughan near Toronto. To do it, they'll have to navigate through the treacherous Rocky Mountains. First, they must guide their train through the snow-covered Selkirks, then the avalanche zone 1,300 metres above sea level at Rogers Pass, before hitting the heart of the ice-encrusted Rockies.
Oh, I got a cold nose. It's cold outside. Every year there's always that one snowstorm, and this year we had massive dumps of snow across the mountain. The threat of an avalanche is always there, especially with the amount of snow we've been getting.
Geordie and Jim's train 100 heads east right into the heart of the avalanche zone. It's down to avalanche technician Derek Melonson to assess just how bad the risk of a snowslide is.
We have absolutely humongous mountains that have avalanche paths that directly impact the railway, and if we aren't able to go control these areas, then they have the potential to build up to some of the largest avalanches possible.
It was here through the Selkirk Mountains in 1881 that surveyor Major Albert Bowman Rogers discovered a passage to connect the railway from east to west. It took just a year for construction crews to lay the tracks through this zone. But running trains through these mountains came at a cost. In 1910, an avalanche claimed the lives of 62 workers. It was dangerous then, and it's still dangerous now.
I'm looking for a protected area of snow so I can dig a snowpack profile, so I can identify weaknesses within the snowpack that might fail. We've had very large avalanches coming down over the railway quite frequently this season. So this is my 3-meter snow probe. Right away off the bat, we have a 200-centimeter snowpack here.
A 2-meter deep blanket of snow sits directly above the rail line. It's not a question of if it will slide, but when.
Avalanches can easily take out mature timber and clear out entire forests if large enough. You can't get complacent while out here. It's Mother Nature, and anything can happen. I'm gonna start digging some of this snow out and start my test. There's been a weakness kind of established itself right in here. Here we have some ice formations.
The snow-covered mountain peaks are nurseries for avalanches. Rain and heat from the sun causes freshly fallen snow to melt. As temperatures fall below zero at night, this water freezes to form a layer of ice. As more snow falls, these layers of ice become buried and compacted. The fresh snow building up on top of the slippery ice can become unstable. And when it reaches a critical weight, it will slide off, triggering an avalanche containing a million tons of snow, traveling up to 320 kilometers per hour.
I'm going to administer a series of taps, slowly giving it more impact and more stress to these weaknesses, showing what they're failing today. All the way down here, I had a failure, which is down about 112 centimeters. So we have a meter and 12 centimeters that was actually quite easily triggered here. We do have potential for large avalanches in this area right now that are possibly going to be triggered on this layer. Being over a meter deep, this would be a very large avalanche that would affect the railway. We're looking for really fat and loaded slopes here with the large overhangs on top to get the best results we can from all of our explosives.
There's some cornices there.
I think that has the potential to, you know, pop a slab out.
There's that one there too.
Unless we see anything else really pop out in the next couple minutes here, we'll just go for those two.
Sure.
Oh man, that thing is not small. I think I can make that go with some big booms.
Yeah.
Let's get it.
Okay.
I have two explosives ready to go here. Ready for open door?
Open door.
Once we're in place, we'll throw some bombs.
Derek takes aim at the unstable shelf of snow.
Okay, putting igniters on two bombs.
And here's two bombs.
Just a little bit further in. Fuses are lit.
Fuses lit.
Bombs away.
I've just talked to Chad. He's got large snow plows and snow fighters in place, just in case we hit the rail with avalanche debris today, which I think is quite a possibility.
Now we're just waiting for the boom, and hopefully that cornice releases and gives us some good results.
There's a good blast coming down. See the cloud coming in?
We've taken out a good chunk of that cornice. We popped a small slab avalanche here. We've got probably a size 3 avalanche at least here. And it's still running and picking up mass. Awesome.
Oh, that's cool. Yeah. That might dust the road.
The next cornice is even bigger.
Oh, this is a nice big one, eh? Fuses are lit.
Fuses lit. Oh, we'll go a little further away with the bigger bags.
Should be about to go any second now. There we go. Awesome. Oh, whoa.
That's big.
Great results here. We cleaned out the entire slope. We got a big powder cloud still traveling down the valley here. We've actually got really close to the railway tracks here with this result. This is obviously one of the things we take the most seriously. On the other hand, I do have a lot of fun taking out entire mountainsides with large explosives.
All complete, all explosives are detonated.
So we did get something on the tracks.
Our pile is quite large, 40 meter wide by 3 to 4 meter deep.
Bombing triggered enough snow to fall onto our track. Time to work.